questions.
You do whatever you want. You're running that end of the show, sir. I'm just here to respond. Way back in the primitive days I'm talking about, there was no place where you could go and learn to be a record producer. You did it. I was turned on to George Russell by Cannonball Adderley. He had a very open mind. He could hear lots of things that were not strictly in his bag. And he talked to me about how interesting and he thought valid the George Russell thing was. Again, it wasn't my kind of music, but it was valid music. It was interesting music. There were several interesting people involved. I ended up doing, I guess, 4 albums on Riverside with George Russell groups. The most interesting by far was the one that Dolphy was in. One of the reasons that I was anxious to get that into this reissue series is that's the only time that I ever was in the studio with Eric Dolphy. Eric, I felt, was a major artist. And I was pretty goddamn negative about anything that you could possibly call avant-garde. But I responded quite positively to Eric. In particular, I must say, there are 2 tunes on that album, one of which is Round Midnight, on which his solo is an incredible thing. And the other, which is Nardis. Nardis was originally written by Miles Davis for, it was written as a present to Cannonball. He wrote this for Cannonball to have it available to record on Cannonball's first Riverside album. It's one of the only sentimental gestures I ever heard of in Miles's life. Nardis is a hell of a piece of music. I do remember a situation in which he was taking a solo and proceeded, while playing his solo, continuing to play, he turned a full circle at the microphone. In other words, continuing to play as he got deliberately totally off mic and then came around again, and George thought that was just fine. I said, well, if you were trying to prove that you can play continuously while being completely off mic, if that's what you were trying to do, you succeeded. I think we did another take.
The major scale is the traditional scale from which jazz and all our Western music has evolved. The chromatic scale is the scale which most modern music is based on. This is the chromatic scale. Now, the problem in jazz today is to evolve into the subtle harmonic and melodic resources that this chromatic scale affords without losing the earthiness and swing that good jazz is characterized by.
George Russell was the kind of composer, arranger, band leader who really was able to use his band as a unit expressing his music. in a way that rarely happens in our times. You know, to me, that's the great value and validity of George Russell. But I, you know, I enjoyed working with George because of that. You know, nothing was ever in doubt. He was tremendously self-confident. He knew what was supposed to happen and how it was going to happen. Granting the fact that he was, by definition, a temperamental genius type, he was not a hard man to work with. I think that's a function, and I don't know, I haven't been in any contact with George in a long time, but at the time, at least, I think that was a function of the degree of self-confidence. There was more furor about what avant jazz was, what the new thing, or what, it was more furor about what it was than I think it really deserved. One of the things that I learned by living through that period was take your time before earth-shaking judgments need to be made. Basically, I stayed away from that. There were occasional situations. I can't fully explain four albums with George Russell, except there was something about what was going on that drew me. If you believe in yourself strongly enough, that's all you need to believe in. I mean, I think that was one of the great lessons that John Coltrane learned from Thelonious. The "to thine own self be true." Been a man with a very practical streak in there, in the middle of all of the artistry.